this man and this machine can bring it to you. During this half hour, we will take you aboard to experience Sky 12 Country.
Roger, there's a shooting on East Washington.
Foster.
Jerry, this is the news desk. We need to scramble Sky 12 right away. We have a shooting.
Okay, East Washington.
Caught up with him over the freeway, and I just couldn't believe it. There he was, the van, and right behind him in hot pursuit was four police cars, and actually they were just sitting back waiting to see what he was going to do, and that went on for about 2 miles, and then he made his move. He just had the luck of the Irish with him, because every move he made was kept him away from the police cars. I watched him go through the front yard of a home with police in hot pursuit. And the most spectacular thing was when a police car came up behind and tried to ram him off the road.
One police car had lost it.
And he turned that corner at the freeway, and the exit was blocked. And we saw little white puffs of foam in there. I knew it was all over. And boy, when that van came to a stop, there must have been 100 policemen standing there at the ready with guns drawn. They just did a tremendous job. They waited to make their move.
One of the suspects been shot when he had an ambulance.
Superstition Mountains, you know, they have a nasty reputation, and without doubt that has got to be the ruggedest country that's anywhere within Arizona, because there are very few places to land except down in some of the washes and in the gullies. I don't think a year goes by that Pinell County Sheriff's helicopter back in there to search for people who have turned up missing. And most of the time we get out there, and in a matter of an hour or two we find the people and find that they've just been delayed because they found that the trails are rougher and it takes longer than they thought. But I've been back looking for people who ventured off into the mountains alone. One case comes into my mind of a young man who was from out of state that was in excellent physical condition, and he was a good mountain climber, and he fell. And he fell about 200 feet into a clump of bushes, and there was just no way to spot him except to get right down in next to the cliffs, and I spotted the fellow's leg. It was just a tragic mistake that he made, because it's just a rugged range of mountains. It doesn't forgive. You know, the Superstition Mountains has got beauty about it, all the mystique and the mystery, but it just seems to change with a coat of snow. It almost gentles it down and mellows it down. I've never seen anything look so peaceful and serene as the rugged old Superstition Mountains with a white blanket of snow. know, you'd think that flooding would be a matter of routine, and particularly since we've just had four major floods. This old couple had, were trying to get home, and they drove through a little wash, and they got stuck in the sand. And pretty soon that little wash started roaring with water, and they were there for 2 days. And if we hadn't come along, they'd have probably been there until the flood was over. Boy, were they happy to see us. It just seems like people have one way to go, and if they can't go that way, they don't know what else to do. So they try to cross the washes. I remember a couple of carpenters that had to get to work. So they drove out in the river, got about halfway across, and that was it. They were standing up on top of their cars, and so I came along with the helicopter and lifted them off. There's no doubt I've got the best job in the world. I couldn't tailor make myself a better job. But the sad part of that job is dealing with the tragedies. It's like during the flooding when two cars went off of a road right into the river. And of course they disappeared right away. A couple of the kids got out, but there were a couple that were trapped in it. And it's those kind of things that just tear your heart out, seeing a family standing beside a river just swollen with grief. And there's nothing you can do for their loved ones, but what you can do for them is you can give them some peace of mind by getting in there and getting those bodies out of the car. But it's not only for the relatives, but it's heartbreaking for us. And it's just part of the tragedy that that we see every time we get a flood in the valley. Good time and getting on inner tubes and sliding down the river and laughing and joking and kissing and hugging, and it's great. Stops being great is when we have a dozen people that drown on the Salt River between Saguaro Lake and Granite Reef. That's just an 8-mile stretch. But every year, a dozen people drown in there. And on every drowning that I have been to, and I've been to most of them, it was just a lack of common sense. You know, you can get all steamed up from having a good time and your body's hot, and you suddenly plunge into that cold water and it just seizes you, it cramps you. And no matter how good a swimmer you are, you're not going to get out. There were five rafts, 19 people aboard, and they went over this small diversion dam, and the rafts were trapped between where the water goes over and where it burbles back up. It was like a vacuum holding those rafts in there, and 13 of the people got to shore after they went over the dam. Two people drowned, and there were five that were left in the life in their rafts. DPS and I got there about the same time, and They didn't feel that the DPS helicopter had enough power to get in there and hover and try to pick them off, so the DPS paramedic Clarence Forby got on my skids and tried to reach a girl that was just about to come off her raft, and she was just dead tired, exhausted, and she was trying to hold on to that raft, and we knew that she couldn't last very long, so we backed off and just watched her for maybe 30 seconds. And then she was so exhausted that she just came off and she went face down and disappeared under that muddy water. And we knew that we just had just moments. We had to get her out of the water. And the water was rushing real swift, and the DPS helicopter was above me trying to direct me to where she was, because she would surface every few seconds. And so he told me that she was on my left side. So I kicked the helicopter around and put the belly in the water, and the paramedic grabbed her by the arm as she was going down again. It was that close. It was our last shot at getting her. And we brought her out, and she'd been in the water about 3 minutes. And we got her on the bank, and somehow we got her breathing again. She was a lucky girl. One of the real bonuses with Sky 12 is going to elementary schools, because the kids are at just the age where everything to them is fantastic, and they look at that helicopter and their little eyes get as big as silver dollars. It gives me a chance to show the kids the helicopter, show them some of the things about it, like how to approach it and what it will do. But you know, not only that, it reminds me of when I was in elementary school and I saw a helicopter circling above, and the pilot must have been a nice guy, because he circled around and waved at us and we got all excited. That was the beginning of my helicopter career, right there in that schoolyard. Many things to many people, but to me it was a chance to really learn the helicopter, and the only way to learn it is to teach it. And I did that for a couple of years, training Vietnamese students. One of the things that came out of the Vietnam War was the concept that a wounded soldier is no more than minutes from competent medical help. Well, thanks to an Army colonel who wrote a thesis for his doctor's degree at ASU, they came up with a program of bringing two helicopters to Arizona, operated by the Highway Patrol, and flown by civilians. And that's where I came in. I was chief pilot on this Ames project. And for 9 months, we fall over Arizona with Arizona Highway Patrol helicopters, picking up injured people on the highways and out in remote areas, and applying the same basic concept that was applied in Vietnam. And that Ames project was the forerunner of what is now the DPS Air Rescue Squad. If somebody's hurt, they can be there in an hour, and they can have that person back in the hospital. And you know, those guys carry 600 patients a year. Some of them are highway accidents, some of them are lake accidents, some of them are hospital transfers. It's just incredible what they do. You know, it's probably hard for people back east to believe that we have such a wilderness area out here. You know, 5 miles from downtown Phoenix, we have South Mountain. A 13-year-old girl was up there hiking with some friends, and she slipped and fell, and she hurt her neck and broke her leg, and she was in a great deal of pain. And the area was so rugged that firemen had to hike in for 2 miles carrying stretchers and first aid kits. And the girl was in a lot of pain. So the fire department called for Sky 12, because actually I don't think anybody else could have gotten in there. It was just a very small place perched up on a ledge right next to a cliff.
We have splinted her right leg with a possible fracture. However, she does indicate movement bilaterally on her extremities.
By flying that girl to the hospital, it saved at least 2 hours, not to mention the terrible pain that she was going through. There's a lot of misnomers about flying in the mountains. You know, the downdrafts and the updrafts and all this and that. You're not affected. By using just a little common sense, you know that if you approach the mountains on the leeward side and you have a strong, gusty wind, then you should be out away from it. But for the most part, those updrafts are kind of blown out of proportion. We use updrafts to climb. In other words, you don't have to use as much engine power if you get on an updraft and just follow the ridge. And I'll tell you, there's nothing like sailing over some of these Arizona mountains. And you'll come up over a large hogback and wham, you have 1,000 feet to the bottom. There's two things that the aerodynamics experts say that won't fly, and that is a helicopter and a hummingbird. And as you know, both of them just do an excellent job. And you know, if the worst fails, if an engine fails, they're designed so that they will come down softly. we hope. If you're 7,000 feet over Saguaro Lake and the engine fails, no problem, because there's so many places to land. You know, it's just like one of these little hats that has the beanie up on top with a propeller that goes around in the wind. That's exactly what's happening with a helicopter. In other words, when you lose your power, your clutch disengages the transmission from the rotor and it goes into freewheeling. And if you follow your procedures correctly, you can make a safe landing at the bottom. Now, few people are killed or seriously injured in helicopter crashes. Let's face it, there's a danger in anything that we do. But I think as far as a danger degree, I put that out of my mind. I have confidence in the machine. When you fly these things, you have to, it's almost, I feel like I'm a computer that's sending out impulses to the machine, and the machine is doing what the computer tells. I'm so familiar with the helicopter that I fly, because I fly it every day, without many exceptions, that I know the machine, and I can feel the machine, and that way I feel confident to put my eye through a camera, and my computer, so to speak, is flying the helicopter while I'm concentrating on filming whatever it is on the ground. It works. Arizona is just the right place for a helicopter because we have the mountains, we have the deserts, but most of all, it's because it is so remote. And that's where the helicopter shines. You know, the role of helicopters in Arizona just goes on and on. The Bureau of Land Management and the Forest Service, they depend on them for these fire seasons. You know, it's not uncommon at all for one helicopter and a fire crew to go out and put a bucket underneath the helicopter and sling load 60 or 70 gallons out and drop water on some of those hot spots. Helicopter is probably the best tool that the firefighters have come up with. I remember when the Bureau of Land Management had the problem with the overpopulation of burrows. They adopted a little program to give burrows away. And the way they elected to round these animals up was with a helicopter, because it was a natural. They'd go in there with the sirens and run them just the way that they needed to run them. That helicopter did in a day what it would have taken cowboys months to do. Well, let's take fast-breaking news stories, for instance. Straight line with a helicopter, even if it's down in the bottom of a canyon, you're there. You know, in the television business, we have to be Johnny on the spot. You know, like the newspaper, for instance, they can get there after the story is over and they can find out what happened and they can write it. And then the next morning, the people at home can read about it. But what's expected of us, when people sit down in the evenings to watch their news, they expect to see what happened while it was happening. You know, whisking around at 160 miles an hour, it's possible for me now to get to those stories while they're going on. It used to be that if I saw smoke across town, by the time I got there, it was out. But now, across town's a matter of about 3 minutes. It amazes me the technology that is that's come about over the years in television and, of course, in helicopters. But, you know, when I first started flying, it was in a small two-place machine with a little film camera. And it was the latest and the greatest in those days. But I used to always dream about having a jet-powered helicopter and about being able to go live from the helicopter. That's been a dream all over the country for years. And now, you know, SKY12 is the first helicopter in the world to have a system that's as simple as it is, but yet that is so efficient. You know, it takes me, from when I take off from the roof, 60 seconds later, I can be live on television. It's just an unbelievable thing. The technology has come so far. I just lower an antenna, turn on the microwave system, point the camera, and the folks at home see what I'm seeing. You know, 16 years ago when I first started flying news, I always heard about the KTLA helicopter that could transmit live. And it was a thing of wonderment to everybody. But, you know, comparing the KTLA helicopter to Sky 12, there's just no comparison, because we have a unit that weighs a little over 60 pounds, where theirs weighed a little over 1,500 pounds. And, you know, unlike our competition, we don't have to send our signal to a truck and then send it to the mountain. We just send it directly from the helicopter right straight to people at home. Sky 12 is a satellite. It's capable of beaming a picture, taking a picture from the ground, from another camera crew from the ground, and beaming it back to the station. Memorial Day, while we were given a live report, we had a reporter on the ground. I was relaying his signal back on a live report, and I got a call from the sheriff's office about an accident about 10 miles away. And we're about 15 minutes into our newscast, so we finished this live report at Saguaro Lake, and after I had finished relaying that back, 7 minutes later, I was over this motorcycle accident. I went down into a canyon and videotaped it, and then came back up and shot the videotape through this microwave system back to the station, and the viewers, before the newscast was over, had that story. You know, by using the helicopter as a relay or a satellite, we're not saddled anymore with the rugged terrain. In other words, a microwave works only if you can see the station that you're shooting at. It's a line of sight thing. But with the helicopter now, we can get above the mountains and either beam our own picture or beam a ground picture up. The morning of the Sanderson fire, I got a call. I was in bed at 7:05. I lived 3 blocks from the station, and 20 minutes later, we were on the air live. That particular fire was just, it was spectacular. It was as spectacular a fire as I've seen, with those firemen up in the snorkels and up on the ladder, just completely washed out in smoke, and flames were going 100 feet in the air. It was quite a sight. I think our viewers have come to expect that if something major is going on, Sky 12 is going to be there. It's a big responsibility, you know, that we take very serious. That's why I'm on call 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, because we have an obligation to show our viewers what's going on.
Welcome.